There you
Welcome
go.
back as well.
Have a
Yeah.
good session.
Okay, good. Okay, so welcome to the invited talk to section. So I'm Fa Xiong Wang, and I will co-chair this section with Jihao Mallory. And it is our great pleasure to introduce the invited speaker, another invited speaker for Asia Crypto 2020, Professor John He Chuan. Professor John He Chuan is a professor in the Department of Mathematical Science in the Director of the Industrial in Mathematical Data Analytics Research Center in Seoul National University. He has been working on computation number theorem, cryptology, and information security. He is the co-inventor of grand cryptography, sending calculus on elliptical discrete logarithm, and he's also the co-inventor of approximate homomorphic encryption, hence in his currently actively working on homomorphic encryption in the application. Professor Chuan is an associate editor of Design Code in Cryptography, Journal of Computer Network, and Journal of Cryptology. He received the Best Paper Award in Asia Crypto 2008 in Eurocrypt 2015. He was selected as a Scientist of the Month by Korean government in 2018 and won the Postcode Science Prize in 2019. So today he is going to present his invited talk on approximate computation on encrypted data. Okay, so in the next 1 hour, we'll have the invited talk. And if you have any question, please post your question on the Zoom or chat rooms. Okay, yes, okay, please, John He.
Thank you, Fa Xiong, for your introduction. It's my great honor to give an invite talk in AsiaCrypt 2020. Today, I'll talk about approximate computation on encrypted data. My name is Jung Hee-chun from Seoul National University and CryptoLab. Okay, why do we study homomorphic encryption? So we can see here, many people says, 21st century is the era of data. We can see this from this following diagram. In 2006, out of six largest companies by market cap, only one company, Microsoft, is the IT-related company. But in 2020, all of six largest company is related to IT, and then most of their venues come from IT-related project. So we frequently hear that, we can frequently hear that data is new oil or data will become a new currency. That means more and more people and companies wants to have data than ever before. So then needs some data compromise a lot. In 2018, number of exposed record in the first of 2018, it's like 4.5 billion. Then due to IBM, average cost of data breach per company is 3.8 billion. So most of the data breaches come from healthcare, financial, educations, the ones that are most valuable. So then due to this continued compromise, many countries passed the privacy laws, the GDPR in EU, General Data Protection Regulation in 2018, and then California Consumer Privacy Act in US, and also in Korea, we have three data privacy regulations in this year. So the question is like this, can it be balanced? That is, can we have both of data sharing and data protection? Let us think about this in machine learning framework. As you know, the machine learning is famous for self-driving cars, translations, and AIs a lot. Especially in Korea, it's very popular due to AlphaGo, it's a DeepMind challenges. There, AlphaGo won 4 out of 5 games against the world champion, world Go champion Isedol. Also, it's used in most translations and then self-driving cars. Okay, so let us think machine learning as an algorithm to compute a function f from training data, xi, yi. Here, f should satisfy fxi is almost equal to yi. What if we apply those machine learning algorithm on encrypted training data? Then, oh, it's nothing. We cannot get anything if it's encrypted. But if we apply some specific version of machine learning, I mean some translation of machine learning, then if we apply those translation of machine learning to encrypt data, we might get encrypt of F. In that case, the machine learning algorithm should commute with encryption algorithm. That is, encryption after machine learning should be equal to machine learning after encryption. In that case, we say encryption is homomorphic for machine learning algorithm. Let us dive back into the history of homomorphic encryption. The concept of homomorphic encryption was proposed in 1978. And then later, two lines of research have been done. One line is one operation homomorphic encryption, that is, which support one operation in encrypt state. It includes Elgamal scheme supporting multiplication and Goldwasser-Mikkeli, Okamoto-Uchiyama support additions, and then even post-quantum cryptography these days, including REGEP and then Lindner-Packard schemes. Another direction of research has been done on a multiple operation homomorphic encryption that support more than one operation in encrypt state. For example, BGN scheme support one multiplication and a lot of additions. And after the breakthrough work of Gentry seminar work, we have a lot of research in this area. Let's take a look on privacy homomorphism suggested by Rivest, Adelman, De Duzzo in 1978. They defined this privacy homomorphism like encryption functions which permit encrypted data to be operated on without preliminary decryption of the operand for many sets of interesting operations. Here, they also suggested a concept of a database as a service, that is, where data can be processed by an external computing facility. Also, they proposed some interesting applications. One of them is here. Suppose the loan company stores their data in an outsourced database. Then, what is the size of the average loan outstanding? And how much income from loan payments is expected next month? How many loans over $5,000 have been granted? So to obtain the answers for those questions, we need to perform some computation on data. But if we outsource the data, it it could leak some privacy of data. So their scenario wants to perform those computation on encrypted data. They proposed several schemes in their paper. Let me introduce one, which is most interesting one. It is a symmetric encryption scheme. Here, secret key is a large prime P, like a 1000 bit prime. And then operation key is a multiple of P, P times a random integer Q0 is, let's call N. Then the encryption is like this, given a message or plain text between 0 and P, the encryption of M is M plus a random multiple of P. That is here Q is a random integer, and then take modulo N to reduce the size. That is the encryption M is M plus PQ. What's decryption? Decryption is encryption M modulo P. Just by taking modulo P operation, we can obtain the message M. This is very simple and elegant. And then more, further, this scheme has a very interesting property, that is homomorphic property with respect to addition. That is, if we add two encryptions, then this encryption of M1 and M2, the addition of M1 and M2, addition of encryption of M1 and M2 gives encryption of M1 plus M2, because those P part can, here M1 plus M2 is message part, and then PQ1 plus PQ2 becomes a random part. Also, furthermore, if we multiply two ciphertext, we can also obtain encryption of M1 times M2. That is, this encryption is ring homomorphic. That's preserve addition and multiplication. So it's very desirable. It's very good. What's the problem? So it's secure against no message attack. But what if we have a pair of plain text and ciphertext? That is, if we apply known plain text attack to this RAD scheme, then we can break the scheme by reducing secret key from the difference of plain text and ciphertext. Previously, we know ciphertext always, and then if we can guess the plain text M, the difference gives a multiple of P from several pairs of those plain text and ciphertext pairs. We apply a Euclidean algorithm to get the private key P. Okay. Unfortunately, it's not secure, even though it has a lot of good properties. So how to make it secure? One approach is to adopt more complex mathematical structure, but it turned out not to be successful. Let me explain the reason here in this slide. Let's consider a decryption algorithm like this. What if decryption algorithm between the abelian group G, then if decryption algorithm is a group homomorphism for an abelian group G, then from several plaintext ciphertext pairs, we may deduce decryption of generators. Then in that, if we know all the decryption values of generators, then we know everything about decryptions. For any element in the ciphertext, we represent those element as a product of generators. And then by using the previous information about the decryption of GI, we obtain the plain text of the target element. it requires only k log k ciphertext plaintext pairs. So it's very efficient. So it's not so good. It's not a good approach to increase the rank to hide plaintext ciphertext pairs. Actually, the Mauro in 2007 showed the impossibility of fully homomorphic encryption without randomness. That is, his statement he proved is field homomorphic 1A permutations over fields of small characters P, in particular over GF2 to DK, do not exist. That is, if the decryption is field homomorphic, it's broken for two finite field F1 and F2. So it, at that time, it looked very unlucky to try to design some field homomorphic or ring homomorphic encryptions here. Gentry, in 2009, Gentry presented a paper, announced a paper. His breakthrough idea is to adopt a noise. That is, noise computation allows only finite number of operations, which are not enough to break the scheme. So if we adopt a noise in the scheme, that does not allow unlimited number of operations. So it becomes, it could be, become be secure. So let us adopt this idea to RAD schemes. Then the encryption algorithm slightly modified like this. Encryption of M is M plus some noise plus P times Q for random Q, a multiple of random secret key. So in that case, if you add two ciphertext, that gives addition of plaintext. And then from the addition of plaintext, we can deduce some message additions, M1 plus M2. It is secure under approximate GCD assumptions. Also, if we multiply two ciphertext, we can obtain in the previous RAD scheme, we can obtain multiplication of plaintext. Here, plaintext means message plus noise part. So we can see here in the diagram, here the LSB part, we have message M1, 100 bit. And then here, next, we have 100 bit noise generated by computer and then removed after the generation. If we multiply two plaintext, then we obtain M1 times M2 modulo 2 to the 100, and then some noise here. So after the multiplication of ciphertext, we can obtain multiplication of plaintext, and then we can deduce the multiplication of messages. So this scheme also support multiplication, as well as additions. Those ideas was extended to a polynomial ring, and then that yields recent homomorphic encryption schemes. These days, most of schemes rely on those polynomial ring. Here, the ring RQ is the set of polynomials of degree less than n, and with a coefficient in G mod Q. G mod Q means a coefficient belong to an coefficient is an integer between 0 and Q. Then ciphertext is like this. An element of A of RQ, and then B. B is computed like this. A times secret key S. S is another ring element. And message, another ring element. And then plus 2 to the 32 times small coefficient polynomial. When the message is 32 bit coefficient polynomial, then here we take secret key as minus S and 1. When we have ciphertext and secret key, if we take inner product, we can obtain minus AS plus B, and it gives M plus 2 to the 32 E. Since M is 32-bit coefficient polynomial, and then E is small, we can remove those part, those noisy part, to obtain the message. This is recent homomorphic encryption, most popular one. Okay, the EFTO gently proposed this idea. There were numerous FH schemes. As a second generation, we have more efficient FH schemes, which have depth linear construction. They used modular switching technique. And in third generation, without modular switching technique, they obtained slower noisy growth. And then it was used to have a fast bootstrapping. So the bootstrapping latency became smaller in this third generation scenario. So here is a question. Then, can arithmetic operation be efficient with those FHs? We can, but it's not so efficient. We can compute, we can evaluate any arithmetic operation with those FHs, but the operations are not so efficient. Why? We can see here in the region. Since the multiplication is supported by homomorphic encryptions, it's easy to compute a product of all 8 numbers. But the problem is the number of digits doubled after each multiplication. So it increases exponentially. How to compute it in usual plain text computation? In usual computations, we do rounding after each multiplication or after some operations to keep the size of the digit. So in 2017, the CKK scheme proposed new homomorphic encryption schemes, which support addition, multiplication, and one more, rounding. So in one special property of this scheme is the plain text is not a finite field of character P. Its plain text is like a complex numbers of characters 0. So we can see that partial homomorphic encryptions allow only one single operation, and then some fully homomorphic encryptions allow two primitive operations. So it became Turing complete. But here, CKK scheme has three hands. That is, it supports three primitive operations redundantly. So we expect that it allow more efficient evaluation for many operations. Let us briefly introduce Heian scheme and its operations. Heian encoding is like this. If the ciphertext is an encryption of message polynomial M under the secret key SK, then inner product of secret ciphertext and secret key becomes P times M plus E. Here, P is a scale factor, which is word size, for example, 2 to the 32. And then here, E is the message noise as a small coefficient polynomial. Then, that is, when we have a ciphertext, if we take an inner product, we'll get PM plus E. We call sometimes it's a decryption structure. And then, if we add two ciphertext, we obtain addition of plain text, And then it gives almost P times M1 plus M2. For the multiplication, the multiplication of ciphertext gives multiplication of plain text, and then it corresponding to P square M1 and M2. In the audition case, it preserves the format, that is, it's almost P times the message part plus error. But in multiplication case, the scale factor became P square. So we need to reduce this P square into P, this operation called rounding. By taking rounding operation to the ciphertext, we can obtain the rounded plain text, and also we can obtain the P times the message part here. So in the diagram, explain this one. This is plain text, and then in the last part, we have message and some noise. Noise is regarded as a message noise in this case. By multiplying those things, and we obtain this, and then here, scale factor become P square. By rounding the ciphertext, we can cut off the several LSB bits, and then noise becomes smaller. After each operation, the modulus reduced by some bit, and then for L multiplication, the modulus should be P to the L in these schemes. Let's go to approximate computation. Okay, now we can do fixed point arithmetic on encrypted data using CKK scheme. Then the problem is, how can we approximately evaluate arbitrary functions efficiently by repeating addition, multiplication, and rounding? One good example is decryption, the bootstrapping. Bootstrapping is a evaluation of decryption function. In CKK scheme, they use approximate bootstrapping, that is, evaluation of approximate decryption. As we've seen previously, decryption is like this. If we take decryption function on ciphertext, it gives an inner product of ciphertext and secret key. And by taking modulo Q operation, we obtain mu. Here, let us write T as Q times I plus mu for some integer polynomial I whose coefficient is less than K. How to compute mu from ciphertext CT using multiplication and additions? One naive solution is to use polynomial interpolation, but it requires huge depth. So one idea is take early decryption. It makes mu much smaller than Q. Previously, mu can be any integer between 0 and Q, but by taking early decryption, we can keep mu much smaller than Q. Then we approximate those modulo Q function as a sine function, trigonometric sine function. Since mu is small, near zero, it's like black lines. And then for those black lines, we can see this, if the interval gets smaller, it's more closer to sine functions. And then using double and add formula, we compute polynomial approximate sine functions. This is the approximate bootstrapping procedure. Using those techniques, we can accelerate bootstrapping a lot. In 2011, when the first bootstrapping was implemented, it took 30 minutes for 1 bit. And then we had a lot of improvement using some ideas and some implementations. Here, y-axis is log scale, so it's very steep. And then in 2020, in amortized time sense, it took only 17 milliseconds to bootstrap in 1 bit. That is, the bootstrapping speed has increased almost 8 times a year. It's a lot. So for the improvement, recent improvement, it's due to those approximate bootstrapping algorithms. Okay, then to obtain approximate, to do approximate computation, does conventional numerical analysis work? Yes, definitely, but not always efficient. Why? The reason is from these differences. In conventional numerical analysis, they use plus multiplication and then division and if operations. All of 4 operations are very efficient. But in our approximate homomorphic framework, addition and multiplication are a bit efficient, but division and comparison operations are not so efficient. And also, we have different performance measure, not only accuracy. We should count number of multiplication and then depth of the circuit. So for example, for the division should be computed using this identity. So the division is not easy. Here we should take R multiplication with some additions. And for example, another example comes from sigmoid. Sigmoid function is popular for logistic regression and many neural networks. And then since sigmoid function is a transcendental style function, it's hard to get a good polynomial approximation. So, but we should apply numerical analysis to get good approximation of sigmoid. One example is like this. Okay, so the next example is comparison. It's an interesting example. Comparison function is not a continuous function. It's discontinuous function. But how to evaluate comparison function with only addition and multiplication? One idea is to use this identity. The comparison of max, okay, here. If A is larger than B, when we take a large exponent K, B to the K becomes nothing, and then it goes to 1. And then if B is larger than A, it goes to 0, so it gives a comparison value. If A is larger than B, it's equal to 1. If B is larger than A, it's equal to 0. How to compute those division approximately? Here we choose K as a power of 2, and then we use division algorithm repeatedly. So here, by using addition and multiplication and division, division is referred to the previous iteration algorithm. And so we can compute the comparison functions here. But next question is, can we do this without expense division? Yes, the answer is yes. By iterating a polynomial, we can obtain those functions. Here, this F1 function in the graph, F1 function is like this one. And then the red one. And then by iterating those polynomials, it becomes cyanic one and then blue one like this. It approaches to step function. So we can also use higher degree polynomials. For more details, refer to the this paper, and then the presentation will be given tomorrow. Okay, we can try to generalize those ideas. How about the maximum of several elements? It's like this. If we take limit here, this gives the maximum of A1 through AK. Also, by using similar ideas, we can compute second maximum, and then K-max, and threshold counting, clustering, etc. But for those examples, we do not know yet how to compute a good polynomial approximation without inversion. And also, we can extend those problems into arbitrary functions. Let's look, take a look of application of approximate homomorphic encryptions. In the literature, we can see a lot of applications of approximate homomorphic encryptions. The load includes logistic regression and prediction phase of neural network and the GIS computation and the decision tree and dynamic programming and even sorting networks. Here, sorting network could be accelerated using the previous comparison functions. Let's see logistic regression. The last year, the practical size logistic regression result on encrypted data was announced. In their result, they used real financial large data and then about 400,000 samples with 200 features. The target value is credit score. That is, using this logistic regression, they want to train credit score model. They obtained accurate 80%, and then it took 16 hours. It's large, but can be practical in some sense. And then this scenario became real world applications. In 2000 June, using those techniques, the personal credit rating model was improved by combining pension data and credit data. The procedure is like this: encrypt data with hand, and then combine them and analyze correlation of pension payment and credit score in encrypted state, and then decrypt it and to modify the model. And then it is in use in Korea since October 2020. That is, if you submit a pension payment certificate to credit bureau, your credit score will be re-evaluated in Korea. Another example is related to genome analysis. IDESH is a competition for secure genome analysis date back to 2014. And then they have a homomorphic encryption related task from 2015. The first task was chi-squared statistics and edit distance and testing for genetic disease on encrypted genomes, and then logistic regression model learning and secure parallel GIS in 2018, secure genotype imputation in 2019. And this year, the task is secure multi-label tumor classification. All of them are related to a genome-wide association studies and in encrypted state. Okay, next example is related to control systems. This picture shows how to hack a car using let me explain the scenario how to hacking a car. Turn on the Jeep radio, rewrite code embedded in the entertainment system hardware, and issue command through the internal network to steering brakes and the engine. Okay, how to prevent those security threats on cyber physical systems? Let's take a look at the general dynamic control systems. Here, plant, the sensor sends some data from the plant and encrypt and transmit to the controller, and the controller decrypt it, and then solve some differential equations and send the command after encryption to the actuator. So the network is network security is preserved here, but when controller compute something, the malware can can yield some malfunction. How to prevent this one? We can use homomorphic encryption to securing those cyber physical systems or control systems. If we encrypt the sensing data and command data using homomorphic encryption, we do not need to decrypt in the controller. So we can hide the signals and then becomes more secure. And then to get more security, we should consider homomorphic authenticated encryption here or verified computations. Here is some papers deal with those problems, issues. If you have secure homomorphic encryption for those control systems, we can apply this one to smart car, drone, robot, and AI, etc. Okay, it is the last part of this talk. These days, we have lots of several open source HE libraries, include Helip, Shell, Heian, Palisade, and Letigo. If you want to try homomorphic encryptions or approximate homomorphic encryptions, you can visit the website here. And then another attempt to make use of HE easier includes some compiler, making compiler. Intel announced a compiler based on TensorFlow. If someone program in TensorFlow, the transformer compile this program into a program work on HE encrypted ciphertext. And a month ago, Microsoft Research announced the EVA compiler for Shell. It's an encrypted vector arithmetic intermediate representations. And then CryptoLab has announced PyHeian. It's a Python interface. This runs in plain text, so it's very fast, but has the same functional with homomorphic encryption program. But and then also it provides some estimation of performance over encrypted data. Now we also have several standardization activities. It begins from homomorphicencryption.org, and is in 2017 in Microsoft, and then 2018 in MIT, and then Toronto. And in Korea, already we had complete the standardization for homomorphic encryption. And in ISO, now it's an ongoing project. Another interesting news, DeepRive program in DARPA has been announced. The goal is to design FHE hardware accelerator. It should be 10x overhead compared with plain text computations. That is, if some computation takes 1 second in plain text, it should be taken, it should take 10 seconds in ciphertext if we use some hardware accelerator. That's the task, 4 years task. And then their challenges, like their task is like specific task includes logistic regression training, and then CNN inference, and then CNN training. Okay, it's a further works. I introduced some efficient evaluation using approximate homomorphic encryptions. So one good question is to represent approximate arbitrary function as an iteration of polynomials. And then some efficient rotation could be another interesting problem because it will lead to efficient matrix operations. Also, on the other hand, we can think of some homomorphic machine learning, which use only HE-friendly functions. That is, rather than sigmoid functions, we can consider some polynomial functions. Also, approximate computation in homomorphic authenticated encryption or multi-party computation would be very interesting questions. And I don't know whether it's easy or not, but actually with more hands, like more primitive operations, would be very interesting one. And also compiler or hardware accelerator of HE ongoing works. And then more, I'm expecting more real world applications. Okay, by doing this, I expect that in near future, all the datas, most of datas are stored in cloud or computers after encryption and processed without decryption, and then only decrypted when a human wants to see the data in small device. And so a handheld device will show the result. So it's hard to hack. Thank you for your attention. For more information, you can visit ahan.org.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Chuan, for the excellent talk. So now we have Q&A time. So any questions from audience? Okay. Okay, so you in question or comment, please post in the room chat, or you can put it in the Julie. But before any question, I have a quick question. Okay, so in one of your slides, you show that for these hands, you reach this bootstrapping state in a very efficient way, right?
Yeah.
And do you think this is the limit or still there's some space to improve?
Pardon, and let me volume up a little bit. Okay. Say again, there, yes.
Okay. So in your slide, you show that this hand is already very efficient for this bootstrapping speed.
Yes, yes.
Right. And do you think this is already the optimum or the limit or still some space to improve it?
Your question is whether the approximate homomorphic encryption, how approximate homomorphic encryption can accelerate the bootstrapping?
Yeah. Okay.
For the to accelerate bootstrapping, so the we use the approximate nature. That is, yeah. In the previous approach, the bootstrapping has been computed using Boolean operations, and then in that case, some arithmetic of large integers could be very inefficient. But here we use the large size arithmetic itself rather than breaking it into Boolean operations.
Okay, yeah. Good, thanks. Also, another question, in your application example, you have mentioned, for example, like a credit score ideas in this hacking card. You mentioned this HE, not FHE. So in this application, you only use HE, not FHE, right?
Good questions. So your question is whether we use the somewhat homomorphic encryption or fully homomorphic encryption in those scenarios.
Yeah.
In IDC applications, mostly we use the somewhat homomorphic encryptions that are enough. Yeah. But the homomorphic control scenarios, since it requires unlimited bound of times, fully homomorphic encryption is necessary for that scenario. And also for credit score scenarios, we used some statistics and machine learning on encrypted data. So it requires huge depths, which is much more than the capacity of current somewhat homomorphic encryptions. So for most of function, fully homomorphic encryption, and that is the bootstrapping, is necessary for the applications. But I think the many applications are enough for somewhat homomorphic encryptions are enough for many applications.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Okay. Okay. Yeah. I think. Okay. You have a question. Can you see from the Zoom group chat?
Yes.
Question. Yeah. Okay.
The question is, do you think secure fully homomorphic encryption schemes are necessarily noisy? Yes and no. I think I couldn't find any good idea to avoid noise in designing fully homomorphic encryptions. But as the previous case, when Gentry made a good idea, even though many people think fully homomorphic encryption is impossible, I think some new direction of ideas can occur. So I don't remove the possibility that some fully homomorphic encryption is designed without noise. But in that case, we should think very differently.
Okay. Good. I also check from this Judith. Okay. No, at a moment. Okay. Okay. Any other question or comments from audience? Okay. If no, thank you very much, Professor Chuan, for the wonderful talk. Yeah. And thank